was born in Africa 150,000 years ago.
There were no races then, just a pack of primates striving to survive.
A great big family spread throughout the world in search of a better place.
Since the first time we left Africa, we've always been a migrant species.
This is America.
The first humans arrived over 30,000 years ago during a glaciation period.
According to some, it is two continents. North America and South America.
According to others, it is a single continent represented by the red ring and the Olympic symbol.
A single strip of land connecting pole to pole.
If you're persistent and strong, you can head to Fairbanks, Alaska to go see the Northern Lights, and then walk to Tierra del Fuego in Argentina to see the Southern Lights.
It is a journey of almost 15,000 miles. Not many people can make it.
The first humans who saw the Southern Lights took almost 8,000 years to get there.
By then, the polar ice had melted, and mankind was separated into different land masses for thousands of years.
We were split for so long that we lost memory of each other.
We're a lousy migrant species. The monarch butterfly never forgets its life journey that it makes from Canada to Mexico each year.
But people, we forget.
Everyone in this theater, actors, audience members, we want to be remembered in 100 years.
So according to the first official story in most of America, Christopher Columbus was the first man that reunited the family.
But 500 years before, Leif Erikson and his brothers built a Viking colony, and it lasted several winters.
Yeah, but Columbus was different. He always had big dreams.
I have a dream. Tainted by the blood of my ancestors. It's a recurring dream. I'm sitting over the crest of a wave so blue and purple. I'm riding the crest of this wave like the wet, cold hump of an infinite camel walking endlessly the horizon.
¿Dónde está? Ah, sí. Espera. Ah, no se puede.
Pero ya hay lugares. Aunque sea de la tercera edad.
Espérate hasta que vea la luz para ver.
This is my husband Fernando, King of Aragon and Sicilia. After 800 years, we finally restored the former glory of España. We kicked those fucking Moors and Jews back to Africa where they belong. Tell him, Your Majesty. My lord. Fernando!
Yes, my queen?
You fell asleep again.
I didn't. Oh, can't help it, dear. You're boring.
What?
You are! Look at this lad. Even I saw him. He fell asleep way before I did.
I was just telling this pipsqueak about how you defeated the Moors and expelled them from our peninsula.
You should have seen it, boy. Those damn Muslims think they know it all. They come here with their science and laws and try to impose their honor onto decent Catholic people. But we don't need their knowledge. You've seen their skins. I never saw something as dark in my life. And you want to know why? Come closer. Closer! A demon called Allah. They don't drink alcohol, but they feast
chicken bones left over from a feast. You could crush them easily if you wanted to. Come on, try.
Calculations were wrong.
He was so stubborn, he was willing to take all his men's lives to prove he was right.
He was so stubborn that he died believing he had reached China, India, and Japan.
And even though he was so wrong, he really was a lucky bastard.
But he was not a bad man, he just aimed too high. And then he got power. Power changes men.
He's a demon on my spats too, Rodrigo! It punishes me for having impure thoughts.
Admiral Columbus, a lot of our men are very, very hungry. Oh. There is nothing left to eat. We think it might be time to call this whole mission off.
We can't go back. We're on a mission from God.
Well, maybe God is trying to send us a message. Maybe your toe is a warning of what awaits us if we don't go back right now.
What do you mean?
A lot of men are starving. Some are sick, many have died!
It's a rough world, Rodrigo! Only the strong survive, and only the strongest are remembered!
Yesterday we lost a man to some strange disease. It could be the black...
We'll get there! I'm sure, as the earth is round.
Yes, but we'll all be dead by then!
If you do not trust me, you should not have boarded this caravel!
No, perhaps I should have!
All your fucking things!
Columbus, you are not alright. You are even cursing God.
I am not cursing God. It is the demon of my tongue speaking through my mouth, asshole.
It's been 2 months and there's no sign of land!
We'll get there! Even if I have to endure 1,000 days of hunger, even if we lose every last man, I'll eat your dead bodies if I have to!
But, like, why are you so obsessed with this?
You really don't know, Rodrigo? Why then, I'll tell you how this world works. You can give your heart to Jesus, and you can be the best of men, but there's always someone strong enough to put your ear in. If you think that working hard's enough to get you through your days, think all the more to do to slay or turn them into slaves. After so much pain and suffering, and working off our youths, we're not stronger, we're not richer, I look just as rude as you. But there's a secret you must know, my friend, to clean your best your ears. There's no such thing as a god on earth, people like you and me. Now, get off me! We've been told since we were children that working means success. And we believe that fucking lie and play into their game. But kings don't work their asses off, they only eat and drink. And the reason they can do so is they don't have power over me. The key to their success is only making us believe we're weak enough, good enough to fall down to our knees. So the only real way that you can get what you deserve is taking it from others weaker than yourself. Now what is the nature of that power, you ask? Why do the kings slaughter a million wars? Because they can't burn all their wealth and clothes and books. Because they can. Repeat that to me, Rodrigo. Because I can.
Because I can!
Because I can. And that's reason enough. Why did you long who can impale everyone in Baghdad?
Thank you.
can.
Admiral Columbus! Admiral Columbus!
It's Martin Pinzon from the Nina!
Land in sight! Land in sight!
They're firing the Lombard, sir! We found land!
Of course we did! This is the mysterious island of Japan. Only the most savage of men live here. We will show these savages what we can do in the name of Jesus Christo!
Admiral, sir! We found one of them!
Oh, a Japanese Indian. What a nice piece of flesh. Come here, Rodrigo.
Yes, sir.
Look, his face is covered in gold. We found it, Rodrigo. We found the power we were looking for. Now bring me another one of these. I will interrogate him. And don't forget to show them the body so they know we were sent by Jesus.
Here's another one.
What is your name, son?
Bocoro. Paquetia. Good America. Muegua.
He speaks the language of the devil! Branch him with the cross, Rodrigo! Now he can become a good Christian like us. Bring me more of these things. They will make excellent slaves.
So?
Ha! Their blood is red, just like ours. They will make perfect gifts for the Catholic kings until we find their gold. Because we can!
Columbus returned to Spain after conquering two lands. He brought tens of native slaves with him.
He called them Indios. They were carried like cattle. Only seven survived.
When Columbus returned to the Catholic king's court with the slaves and the gold, he was named Grand Admiral of the Holy Kingdom of Spain.
His story marked an unprecedented rage for adventure.
Italian sailor John Cabot claimed Newfoundland for the English crown in 1497.
And Pedro Alvarez arrived in Brazil in 1500, and he claimed it for the Portuguese.
It was all one of Pedro's journeys that another adventurer realized something.
This is not the Indios. This is a new world between Europe and Asia.
His name was Amerigo Vespucci.
In 1502, he wrote a letter to his master, Lorenzo di Pier Francesco de Medici.
In his letter, Modus Novus, he said that the lands found by Columbus were indeed a new world, yet undiscovered by their culture.
Columbus learned about this and he died in denial.
So he didn't actually discover America, yet he's remembered as a hero.
Even if some of the most horrible crimes against humanity were committed during his time.
It is said that one time...
Admiral Columbus! This Indian wants to steal one of my guns!
Bocora Cucuz.
I hate it when Indians try to have free will. Cut his ears and nose, and make him a gent from now on! Show me where you can show my boy!
Ignite the flames, he established the way.
My name is Hernan Cortes, conqueror of the Aztec Empire, and I proclaim this land New Spain in the name of the Holy Spanish Crown because it can.
My name is Pizarro, Seiya of the Incas, and I baptize this holy city as Lima, capital of Peru, under the Holy Spanish Crown because I can.
My name is Jocotiel, and I claim this land for God. And Francois the Fifth, Holy King of France, because I can.
My name is Pedro Menendez de Riles, and I claim the land as St. Augustine of Florida. In the name of the Holy Spanish Crown, because I can.
I'm Captain Christopher Newport, and I name this town Jamestown, property of Virginia Company of London and King James the First, because I can.
My name is Adrian Block, and I claim this land for the Royal Dutch Company because I can.
I am Robert Camillard de Gassay, and I claim this land, Louisiana, to honor the Diocon, Louis XIV, and the Holy French Empire because I can.
The amount of gold and silver
things for money and religion.
We'll save their souls, even if we have to cut all their heads to do so.
In just 200 years, the legacy of Christopher Columbus was complete.
95% of the Native American population was killed by wars, slavery, and disease.
Perhaps the best example of this is the island of Hispaniola, now Haiti in the Dominican Republic, the site of Columbus' first colony.
There is no trace of the original Taino population that used to inhabit those lands.
They were exterminated 50 years after Columbus arrived.
Countless languages and cultures were lost during this time, called colonialization, named after the man who started it all. We don't even know who they were.
And that was the beginning of America.
We are taught that modern history starts with World War II, but the truth is it goes way before.
There's no such thing as modern history. History is an endless spiral.
We can't keep repeating the same mistakes over and over again.
The story of America has never seen the end of colonialism.
It's a story of power, written in the blood of those who used to live here.
Mexico is a land of sacrifice.
Even before the Spanish colonizers arrived, they were ruled by tyrannic and superstitious emperors.
The Aztecs sacrificed 30,000 people a year between 1325 and 1521.
After all, they killed 6 million in their holocaust!
Every twilight, the sun god lost his blood and demanded sacrifices to replenish it.
This act consisted of extirpating the victim's heart with a jade or a city at night.
During their flower wars, Mexicas captured thousands of enemies who were slain on festivities!
It's understandable that the superstitious and Catholic Spanish would think that they were demons.
Oh, hey! Where are we going?
What's this? Hey, what's going on? Wait, no, put me down.
Wait, no, wait,
no, I don't like this!
No, 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 no!
After the conquest, there was a big debate concerning Native Americans in Valladolid.
Indians are not men! They are demons! How can Fray Bartolomé state that they are human after such depiction of witchcraft and dark arts? Every one of you should know there's a natural law. Aristotle knew about the mouse of God our Lord. There's a natural place for people, black, Indian, or more. But white are the superior people God wants us to rule.
Above everyone else, above everyone else.
Those are not the words of Jesus. Have you read at all? There is neither Jew nor Greek, and neither slave nor free. There is neither male nor female.
I claim victory in the debate.
Yeah!
And the battle for white supremacy in the Americas was just getting started.
Native Americans were wiped out by diseases while Europeans migrated into the New World, claiming new lands.
Soon, the amount of resources found in the colonies was far superior than the labor force available to exploit them.
The fast-growing industries of farming and mining needed workers.
The Portuguese took advantage of the routes and ports in Africa to trade slaves.
And soon, the
by religion. Baptized slaves were treated as indentured servants and were given lands to work. In 1519, 19 African slaves arrived in Jamestown. They were stolen commodities from a Spanish ship. Because they were baptized, they were eventually released and given new lands to work. Later, one of those former slaves, Anthony Johnson, would sue another landowner, Robert Parker.
Of the property of Negro John Kaser, who happens to be my servant for life.
Kaser claims that his years of indenture are
contract. He was bought in Africa as a slave.
The court of Jamestown declares that John Kasem belongs to Mr. Johnson, a servant for life.
The first legal owner of a slave in the Americas was an African-American himself.
In 1662, a law in Jamestown passed stating that any child of a female slave was to be enslaved for life.
Owners were not just expensed from taking care of the sons they had with their slaves, but they also had the legal right to enslave their own children.
This system ensured that people were not only enslaved for a lifetime, but for generations to come.
And something similar happened with the encomiendas, which enslaved millions of Native Americans in Mexico and Peru.
And in 1670, slavery was a legal, growing business.
In the New World, African slaves and Native Americans had that in common.
Both groups were victims of white European supremacy.
These are some of the laws passed in Jamestown in those years.
Summertime, and the living is easy. Fish.
Among men, deriving their just powers from the consent of the governed. To which any government becomes obstructive of these ends, it is the right of the people to alter or to abolish it.
However, that did not apply to slaves.
In the first 60 years of independence, only two presidents were not slave owners.
John Adams and his son, John Quincy Adams.
But perhaps the best example would be Thomas Jefferson.
He opposed the Atlantic trade and spoke about equality, yet he inherited dozens of slaves from his father-in-law, John Wales.
One of those slaves was Sally Hemings.
Daughter of Master John Wales and slave Betty Hemings, she was a slave to her father by Virginia law.
When he married her half-sister, Martha Wales, Jefferson inherited Sally as a slave.
And when Martha died, he found relief in the arms of her half-sister slave.
What happened, Thomas?
I want to bite my tongue until I die, Sally. She was my wife. You remind me of her. You have her eyes.
Don't cry, Thomas.
Thomas. What can I do to make you feel better?
Sing.
As I went down to the river to...
Jefferson had 6 sons with Sally, each his slave by Virginia law. Some of them died before they were free. In his last will, he released all of his surviving slave sons.
But not Sally. She died a slave.
And he was the very man who wrote,
"All men are created equal. They are endowed by their creator certain unalienable rights. And among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness."
It took another 100 years after the Declaration of Independence to end slavery.
The first years of the U.S. were marked by violent racism and pseudoscientific justifications of slavery.
Even after the Civil War, 2 presidents were still slave owners.
In the 1820s, a Philadelphia physician named Samuel G. Martin collected and measured hundreds of human skulls to try to identify the differences between the races.
A heavy, nice skull collection, all the races of the world! I've collected them since I was a little child. From my studies, I have learned that our race is not the same. Different species have evolved with us. Some of them are best to serve. Some of them have little brains, but only one can rule them all. I can tell all kinds of species just by looking at my skulls. Negro's brains is no efficient. English have the best of all.
In the first years of slavery, slaves were war captives from African kingdoms.
But the trade was so profitable that it became a definitive impact on the world economy.
Soon, those African kingdoms were starting wars using European weapons to capture more slaves.
Slave owners are directly responsible for the greatest genocide inside the U.S.
Over 30 million Africans were forcibly removed from their homes.
Millions of families were split.
Millions of slaves died before reaching the African coast.
Millions died crossing the Atlantic over the course of 300 years.
20 million arrived to the Americas sleeping in their own shit.
This trade was the greatest migration out of Africa since the first humans left.
Even now, real civil justice and equality is far from reach.
At the dawn of the 19th century, the greatest power was born, the Holy Alliance.
These monarchies protected the divine rights of their kings from the republican ideas of France and the U.S.
One of their aims was to restore the Bourbon monarchy in Spain and all the Spanish colonies in the Western Hemisphere.
At that time, almost all the Latin American nations were fighting for their independence.
The last of the founding fathers, James Monroe, was president then.
A veteran of the American Revolution and a disciple of Jefferson himself, he was determined to protect the ideals of freedom and independence.
When he became the 5th president of the United States, he recognized all the nations in the Americas fighting for independence, except for one.
Before recognizing Mexico, Monroe ensured the purchase of vast amounts of land from the agonizing Spain that was losing the war in 1819.
A bargain of $5 million for the territories of Oregon and Florida.
At that time, the U.S. looked like an eagle flying over the world map.
After the purchase, Monroe recognized all the new nations in America.
And in 1823, he proclaimed a doctrine stating
that the American continents by the free and independent condition which they have assumed and maintained are henceforth not to be considered as subjects for future colonization by any European powers,
and
that we should consider any attempt on their part to extend the system to any portion of this hemisphere as dangerous to our peace and safety.
After the doctrine was proclaimed, Simón Bolívar and Vicente Guerrero were fighting for independence in Bolivia and Mexico.
Then, with the help of the U.S., the war soon came to an end.
But there was another side to the doctrine, the Indian Removal Act.
Devised by Monroe himself, this act killed thousands of Native Americans in a massive exodus to exile them west of the Mississippi.
It was necessary, as the growing American population was looking for new lands.
The northern Mexican territories were soon populated with pilgrims from the U.S.
but their lives relied upon slaves. But the 1824 Constitution abolished slavery in Mexico.
To get around this law, they registered their slaves as servants with a contract for life.
But in 1830, mulatto president Vicente Guerrero tried to forcefully release every slave in Mexican territory.
Only by then, the Latino population was vastly outnumbered by the Anglo-American. And they controlled most of the economy, so Texas declared independence.
And the bloody war that followed, the Native Americans were forced out of the U.S. by Monroe, and the Indian Removal Act fought for Texas.
They were promised lands that were taken away from them in the following years in exchange for their support. Instead, they were used as cannon fodder.
But President Jackson had his own plans for Texas. He talked about
extending the area of freedom!
And many more presidents would continue his quest.
In 1845, President James Polk declared that
the United States must expand into the West with violence if necessary.
He spent millions to popularize his expansionism under claim of manifest destiny.
As his propaganda journalist John L. O'Sullivan wrote,
it is by the right of our manifest destiny that we will expand and overspread into the providence of the providence which Providence has given us on the whole continent.
So President Polk authorized an even bloodier expulsion of Native Americans in the reservations and annexed Texas, ignoring Mexican government's opposition.
And with this propaganda, he soon had the support to start a war.
Even if some of the most prominent politicians in the U.S., like Abraham Lincoln or Congressman Joshua R. Kennedy, strongly opposed.
On their own soil, or in robbing them of their country, I can take no part. The guilt of these crimes must rest on others.
Still, President Polk invaded Mexico in 1846, killing thousands of Mexicans and gaining all that territory for only $50 million.
In the following decades, American companies would monopolize the trade of coffee, cacao, cocaine leaves, and tropical fruit in Central and South America.
In the 1850s, under the justification of the Monroe Doctrine, U.S. troops were sent into Argentina, Uruguay, Nicaragua, and Costa Rica.
To protect our national interests, while he invaded Mexico, President Polk signed the Bidlack-Malarino Treaty with the new Granada government, now Colombia.
In it, the U.S. was granted free passage through the Panama Isthmus, the right to build the railroad across, and to militarily intervene in order to protect its interests.
In 1855, this railway was complete. Thousands of Panamanios died building it.
It was the first railroad joining the two biggest oceans, the most important trade route in the world.
U.S. companies had exclusive rights to exploit it. It was so convenient.
The entrepreneurs that built their companies in the tropical paradises of Central America often came from a slave owner background in the U.S.
Perhaps one of the most prominent cases was William Walker.
A Texan tycoon, he organized private military quests in order to conquer new lands.
He declared himself president of the Mexican states of Baja California and Sonora, and later went to Central America, where he became president of Nicaragua.
Corrupt governments were bribed to overlook people's humiliating conditions.
And because our companies were exempt from taxes, the U.S. provided military support to protect these governments from any civil unrest.
American railroad workers had a much higher mortality rate than slaves in plantations in Virginia and Texas.
Blacks, mulattoes, and natives were used to work and die by the Spanish for centuries.
Central Americans were enslaved again after a bitter taste of freedom.
But atrocities were not only committed against workers, as the French consul of Canada, General Rowan Perry, would testify in his correspondence politique.
All Americans are armed with knives and revolvers. The incident, despotism, and brutality of these men is far greater than what was thought of in Europe. For them, human life is worth less than an animal's.
On April 15, 1856, a group of U.S. businessmen were waiting for a ferry in Panama. As hours passed, they hopped from one cantina to another, drinking awful amounts of rum. One of them, Jack Oliver, was particularly drunk and searching for food when he found a young 9-year-old boy, Jose Manuel Luna.
What are you selling, brat?
Cynthia, senor, 5 cents.
Give me that. Tastes like crap. I don't want it.
But you bid it, senor. Now I can't sell it. You have to pay, senor.
I don't have to pay you shit, you damn Negro brat. Whoa, don't fucking touch me.
In retaliation to the murder of that child, Panameños killed 15 U.S. citizens in a riot.
Diplomats from several nations testified in favor of the dead boy, but the Marines occupied Panama in an act that sent a clear message to all of Central America.
Opposition to the abuses committed by U.S. companies will not be tolerated.
Even if it meant violating the most basic human rights.
By the 1860s, slavery had almost been completely abolished in all the Americas.
But the first country to declare its independence was fighting for white supremacy.
The Civil War was killed more U.S. citizens than any other, but it was not the only war being waged.
In order to secure more territories against Mexico, an even bloodier campaign against Native American style.
During the second half of the 19th century, hundreds of wars were fought against
the Sioux,
the Apache,
the Comanche,
the Seminole,
the Yaqui,
the Navajo,
the Otay,
the Yakima,
the Mohawk,
the Bana,
the Kiowa,
the Yavapai,
and dozens of other tribes that lived in that land for thousands of years and fought colonization for centuries.
One of these warriors, Apache leader Geronimo, he hated almost all Americans, but he despised Mexicans most of all.
Mexican troops attacked our camp, killed all our warriors of the guard, captured all our ponies, destroyed our supplies, and killed many of our women and children.
There, Geronimo lost all he had.
I found out that my aged mother, my young wife, and my 3 small children were among the slain. I silently turned away and stood by the river.
After that, the Apache leader held dozens of bloody campaigns.
I have killed many Mexicans. I do not know how many. Some were not worth counting. It has been a long time since then, but I still have no love for the Mexicans. With me, they were always treacherous and malicious.
But people from the U.S. were just the same.
Both the Union and the Confederate States led bloody expeditions against the Indians.
During the Civil War, Geronimo's Apache tribe was massacred.
Chief Mangus, Colorado, went to make a treaty of peace with white settlement at Apache Tejo, New Mexico. They told us that if we would come with them and live near them, that they would issue to us from the government blankets, beef, flour, all manner of supplies. Mangus, Colorado, and half our people went with them, happy that they had found white men who would be kind to them and with whom they could live in peace. No word ever came to us from them. From other sources, we heard they had been treacherously captured and slain.
A 1 year after the Civil War, thousands of Navajo were forced to walk from Arizona to New Mexico, more than 10 miles a day in the sun.
Thousands of women and children died in this trail of tears.
By the end of the 19th century, 1 million people had died in wars and segregation.
But many more were entering the U.S., making the most ethnically diverse country in the world.
The blazing furnaces of American industrialization needed workers to burn. By U.S. troops.
At the dawn of the 20th century, free black people were living the darkest years of segregation.
But Africa and half of Asia were European colonies.
Companies realized that sometimes a worker was cheaper than a slave.
The world was preparing for the greatest wars ever seen.
And that was the beginning of a new era of colonialism, one that continues even today.
Power changes people.
Cliché.
But it's true.
How would you know? You have no power.
I have power over you.
You don't look so powerful from here.
I have power, Shazmina. I bet if I wanted to die right now, you'd lay down right next to me and die too.
Perhaps. But you're still powerless.
How come?
I am nothing.
You're all I have left.
That shows how screwed you are, Corporal Miller.
Whatever.
I think you know.
No, you never curse.
I guess some part of you always wanted me to.
Shazmina!
Jane?
No, Shazmina, come on, get up, it's no time yet.
Jane!
Shut up, I don't want to go yet!
See how screwed you are? You're hearing voices! You're dreaming of dead people!
I'm half dead, you know.
People die all the time, but not you! And you want to know why? Because you know you must take responsibility for all the pain you have caused!
Jane!
I told you, I don't know.
You were dreaming of the war again, weren't you?
Kind of.
It's over now, you know? You'll never have to go back to Afghanistan.
I feel like I never left.
Just sleep.
I can't.
Why not?
I had a dream.
I know you had a dream. You always have a dream.
I can't let go.
I love you, Jimmy.
I know. October 2001. Everything's dark. Sky's like the black mouth of an angry god. It swallows the light out of us. We're nothing but tiny moths flying into dark nothingness. Everyone's uncomfortable. Most of us are trying to sleep, or at least pretending to be. It's the night before we land on the plane, and I can hear some of the rookies trying to identify Afghanistan on the map. It took them 20 minutes just to figure it out. They thought we were going to Arabia, and then they realized we're about 1,000 miles further away.
I never left America before.
Private Malloy said, while the others were pretending to sleep next to me, but I knew they was listening. And then time stopped for a few breaths. And when I finally got used to the silence, I could hear everyone's violent heartbeats, pumping furiously.
Well, never mind. It's a win for us, right?
are we fighting against again?
The Taliban?
Right. Who are they?
I don't know. Some jihadist guys, white beheading, camel riding, clit mutilating, suicide bombing, and flag burning motherfuckers. They hit us hard, and now it's payback time.
Well, it'll be over soon, right?
I guess.
I mean, they attacked us. We have to take revenge.
That's right.
But they're weak, right? I mean, it'll be over
Let
soon.
Let me right? sleep. Look, we have the most advanced military equipment and the best trained men.
We're invincible.
No one can stand up to us.
Right.
Right. Now go on, get some sleep.
Hey, Jimmy.
What?
Well, how could they do it? How could they hit us so hard if they're so weak?
Minds before you go on.
Well, they put a whole cluster of them out there, those bastards.
Actually, most of them mines are left over from the Soviet war.
But that was a long time ago, right?
More than 30 years.
Well, why didn't they clean up the mines after the war?
They couldn't. They've been in war ever since.
But they've been buried so long. How can they still work?
Some of them don't. That one did. You saw what happened.
A full arm combed me, and now it looks like a crushed soda can.
Yeah, what would happen to you?
Well, I'm glad you found me.
Haven't seen you since we were deployed here, Pat Malloy.
Oh, hey, you remember. Well, that was almost 2 years ago.
So where are you stationed at?
Camp Rhino.
No shit. Well, I'm headed there.
Gee, now I gotta pee.
Why?
Well, it's a natural reaction. Every time I think about Camp Rhino, I feel like I gotta pee.
Well, go on. Deserted plane, no one's watching.
Well, maybe the Taliban are. Maybe this is a trap.
Yeah, I'm sure they're counting on your psychologically induced excretory needs.
No, I can't help it. You know, I saw them die before my eyes and tackle guard.
Bye. Do not pee in front of me. At least turn around and go over there or something. Jesus.
It was March the 4th, last year. Even the sea above blasted that day. I saw their roasted corpses and ashes, cooked and spread all over the place where the helicopter crashed. Well, it was on the way back to camp that I realized something like that could happen to me. As long as I'm here, there's nothing I can do about it. I got so scared I peed my pants. But anyway, ever since then, feels great. Okay, I'm done. Let's go. Luckily, we've been headed out of the airport, out of Kandahar. Ever since we got the Taliban out of the airport at Kandahar, we've been headed out. So by summer, I'm out.
So you're headed to Camp Rhino then?
Yup.
Great, so am I.
Why?
I gotta meet up with Sergeant Sandberg.
Sergeant Sandberg, huh?
Well, you don't like him?
Oh, no. It's not that I don't like him. I like him too, but I don't know you.
Go on, you can tell me. Don't tell anyone else. I promise.
Well, I saw him kill this dad and his little girl. He said they were Taliban, but I'm not so sure they were. I mean, we saw them all the times when we were out on a mission. They were farmers.
Hey, you want to hear my advice? Unless you're 100% sure what you're telling me, you don't tell anyone else.
Well, I think you might have done it a few more
That's
times.
That's enough, Malloy. Look, we're at war. People are under pressure. Afghanistan is fucking hot as hell. All that tension and stress, it can mess with your mind. It can make you see things.
Oh, what?
We're not playing a game, you know. We We gotta stick together. We're gonna win this thing. So before you go on telling anybody what you thought you saw.
Oh, I saw it, Jimmy!
That's Corporal Miller to you, Private.
Come on, you gotta believe me. This is.
Shut up. The rest of the walk, he was quiet. I can hear him dragging his feet behind me like a scolded child. And for some reason, I felt an obligation to him. Like a useless little brother that would die without me. He was almost killed that afternoon, and now all he could do was follow my steps, humiliated. I thought we'd never see each other after that, talk to each other. Then, what'd she say?
I don't know. Well, hey, but you liked her, huh? Well, you might see her again. She's our translator after all.
Why'd she speak in Pashto instead of English?
She hates Americans. Someone she knew got blown up in a missile attack, what I heard. But anyway, don't get your hopes up too high. She hates the Taliban, that's why she's helping us. But she's real into Islam. That's why she wears that veil stuff. But anyway, if she's around, that means Camp Rhino ain't too far away. Let's go.
So we headed back into camp, but I couldn't get a look out of my mind. That was the first time I saw Shazmina's green eyes. Gonna hurt you.
You always follow closely while I'm alone, like a scorpion stalking. You've been there for years, waiting for the right moment to dishonor and kill.
I'm sorry. I'll leave now. I don't want to hurt you.
I know what Americans want. I heard about little girl in Iraq.
What little girl?
Everyone knows. The little girl was raped by American pigs in Mamadiah.
No, there's a very strict code.
It was on the news! Everyone here saw, you just don't care. The killer's soldier, he don't think of Iraqis as humans. So he slaughtered family from that little girl like sheep goats. Her brother, her father, and her mother. She was 13. Three soldiers raped her while she hear everyone she loves screaming and dying in the next room. Then the killer of her family appear. She is terrified, but he is quick. Everyone's death, but do not worry. I will not kill you, he said. And then he raped her just a little, and then he shoots her in the face.
Well, I'm not gonna do that. I'm not a damn killer. We're not in Iraq.
What's the difference? We are all the same animals.
Why do you hate us so much? I never done nothing to you.
Kill me now if you want. I will not show my face if I am alive.
I'm not here to kill you, goddammit. Look, we came here so we can stop the Taliban, and then you can show your face.
It's too late. It's been 30 years. You and I were not born started, but you grew up listening rock music and watching TV while African children grew up between Soviet tanks and the weapons you give to the opposition, even though they are savage killers. The Taliban are those children. They lost their families to those savage killers. They are orphans of the war that you fought.
They have their own Sikh interpretation of Islam and all the weapons you brought into Afghanistan.
I know it's all messed up, but I told you, we're here to help.
I see what Sergeant Sandberg does to people. That's no help. It's too late. Everything is dead now. Even this well is dried.
Why? What are you doing? You know what? You're gonna fall like crazy, bitch. Look, I don't know what happened to you, but I promise I can help.
Help? That's all you say. Help. My only brother died in American bombing. That was a big help.
My phone. Come on.
I think they got Lloyd.
I think the Taliban shot you.
No, not the Taliban. It was Sergeant Sandberg.
But why'd he do that?
I saw what he did.
Don't talk anymore. You're bleeding out. Wait.
It was an ambush. They blew up a truck. I don't know how many died. Sergeant Sandberg, he was furious. He started shooting until there was no one left to shoot, and then he went into homes of innocent people, civilians, and started shooting until there was nothing left.
Don't talk anymore, okay? You're in pain. Just, what's it?
Fuck!
Here, smoke this!
Wait!
It's opium, it will help with the pain!
Now, where'd you get opium?
My brother grew up needs to get children to feed! Wait, where are you going?
Get him! I gotta get him!
Don't worry! Somebody will find him! But you have to smoke, okay? You have to rest! Just please, smoke! I promise you will feel better than ever!
We're leaving.
Where you want to go?
I'm leaving. President Obama announced the withdrawal of the troops, and they finally summoned me.
Well, what about us?
What do you mean?
Well, we knew you were leaving, but you said you would take us with you. You promised American passport for our help.
And I'm sure that you will get it. We couldn't have done nothing without you.
Yes, but when? The Taliban were also waiting for you to leave. They will hunt us down. They will hunt me down. We need your help.
We've done enough. You have a president. You have democracy. We've crippled the Taliban, and I'm sure America will continue to support its allies until you get your passport.
Come here, and when we think nothing can make Afghanistan any worse, you actually go and make it worse, and now you want to go and leave a Taliban behind!
I'm leaving next month, and there's nothing I can do about it.
But what about us? I know I gave you everything I had left. You took it from me. You said that I would get
it. I lied! Back in America, I have a wife. She's waited 10 years for me to return. I'm sorry, but this has all just been one big dream, you know? All this suffering, it ain't mine. My real life, my home, is back there. I did not ask for any of this. I'm waking up. And that was the last time I saw Shazmina's eyes. It took almost a year to return. All the soldiers were desperate, and I couldn't get her look out of my mind. I found out I could actually see her face when I was on SMAC. I never told my wife anything about Afghanistan, and after a while it all just seemed like a distant dream. And Shasmina was like a purple flower blossoming in that desert. Then, on September 11th, 2014, I attended a ceremony to remember all those who had fallen in the war. And when I got back, my wife was waiting for me.
The Marines called, Jim. They left a message. They said you wouldn't answer.
I don't want to know.
I think you do. Shasmina is dead, Jim. They say the Taliban tortured her and cut off her head. You don't say anything.
I got nothing to say.
Who's Shasmina, Jim?
I don't know.
That's weird, because you always talk about her in your sleep.
Little Mary Maria Anwada lived with their father, a widower. Their mother died from poor hygienic conditions during childbirth. The little girls spent their lives living like rats, feeding in the trash, stealing, hiding, doing their best to survive in one of the most dangerous places in the world, Honduras. Here you go, girls. A piece of bread. Escuchen me. I have something very important to say. You know well that I give my life for you any day. And it's because, so Papa La Sama, that I have decided go away.
Where are you going, Papa?
I'm going to a land where all our dreams can be fulfilled. I'm going to the United States where everyone is rich.
Don't leave us, Papa.
As soon as I have a decent job, you're going there with me. And once you get there, you will see a land made up of dreams, where there's no war but freedom, no corpses in the streets. And children aren't drug addicts because they always eat. It is but a fall. to help the people take control. But now they have forgotten us. We suffer every day. I'm going there to fight for us, to have what we deserve.
Promises won't be long,
Pa. Los por el bien de Guadalupe.
Bye, Papa.
So years passed, and little Maria and Juana had no notice of their father.
Run, Juana! La policía! Did you get it, Maria? Did you get any food? Run! Come in here, little Juana. You'll be safe in here.
What did you get?
Just a piece of bread.
At least it is better than nothing.
I know it's hard, Hermana, but you've gotta hang in. We're going to where the stars shine brighter and all the children live in laughter. I've been saving stolen money, praying really loud. God gave us this suffering, but now he'll help us
oh,
out.
Oh, yeah.
Who's there? Don't go, sister.
Shut up.
But you're all right. Go up. Who are you?
Hello, Pequeñas. Mary Juan, I presume.
And who the hell are you?
Don't be scared, little girls. But I am your friend. I know you've worked all your life, but soon you'll be safe. My name is Pancho Revolver. I chose the name myself, and I was born in the United, where I became your father's friend.
Oh, it's not true, you're lying. I know those tattoos. Don't get too close, Juana. He's from Mara Salvatrucha.
Who are they?
The deadliest gang in the world. You have to kill the joy, but out of all the killers, they're the worst.
Don't be scared, Soy and Mara, but I am your friend. And I worked with your father back in the U.S. Since he's illegal, he couldn't come, so he asked me to do. So I came back from Gringoland so I could get to you. Not so fast, Kilrita. You're gonna see him, but it's a long, long way. If you wanna see your father, you're gonna have to pay me first.
Oh, but we don't have any money.
Don't you worry, little one, we've always been the end. Lo soy muy bien, hunger hurts, and that's why I'm here. But I don't need any money, just come close to me. I'll take you back to your dad and just you. Give me your virginity.
No, what are you doing?
The boy is out to bring any dad and I sent the book.
Sent him
back. What? Shut up! You filthy whore! You want to see your father or not?
Don't worry, little Juana. It will be over soon. Imagine that his hands were soft, just like an angel's touch. I know he hurts, and after this, we'll never be the same. But to get our wishes granted, it's a little...
Marian Warner gave their virginities away to Pancho Revolver, the Mara Salvatrucha who took them out of Honduras across to Guatemala.
The border police! Quickly, hide this!
What is it?
What do you think? It's cocaine, estupida! Put it inside yourself. No one's gonna search there.
I don't want to do it!
You have no choice! If they catch me, you'll get lost and then you'll be dying here. You need me for protection. There's worse people than me. If you think I'm a bad guy, then you haven't seen a thing. You'll learn what real horror is when you meet the Mexican police. They're ruthless and despicable. They're hateful and corrupt. If they catch you, they'll rape you and make you disappear. They'll cut you into ashes and then they'll let you burn. And then they'll spread your ashes until there's nothing left.
Tengo miedo. Just take it, Juan.
So the little girls went to the border police while Pancho Revolver is hiding. But when they were about to leave...
Wait a minute, little girl. Come here. What have we got there?
You took the pack of cocaine right out of
the...
And... Narco. We're at war with drug dealers.
Please, Tango the barrel.
You don't have any money.
No, I have $20. My father has been sending us some dollars and I've saved it all.
Tommy Bird, it's not enough.
No, no, no! There's more! There's more! I promise! Here! Here! This is all I have. My father gave us this and I robbed the rest.
This might be enough. They're coming, put the
gun in my hand! Stay
on the You're free to go, but she's mine
to take. No, please!
I'm gonna dig so many holes in
there.
Fucking bed!
What are you waiting for, Juana? Go away!
Wait to fuck yourself in the house!
Leave her alone!
Get the puta de merda! Tried to trick me, you little bitch, but you don't know what you're messing with. You did me a big favor in killing the border patrol. He never said you had any money. Give it to me.
No!
Shut up! You mess with my mother? Yeah! You're fucking dead! Find the train.
Which train?
The Bestia, the Beast. The magical train every migrant takes to get to the U.S.
Smells like death, and very soon we'll be crushed. But I live for you, now you'll be safe. I dedicate my life to make sure you get to the U.S.
So we have with LaPoya, a transvestite activist that helped young immigrants on their way. Little Marie and Juan aborted the Bestia, the magical train that would take them to the land of freedom. And a journey filled with friends coming from all the Americas to fulfill their dreams of meeting in the U.S.
Like Pedro, the little boy from Nicaragua.
My mama died in the revolution. My Pedro lives in the States.
Or Clalia, the fat Yoruba witch from Guatemala.
I can see tragedy in your eyes, but you will get there.
Or Sandino, the old Colombian guerrero.
You lost war in Colombia. The only narco's red.
Or the poor Salvadoran man who lost his whole life, Oscar.
Coca-Cola poisoned my waters, and now all of my children are dead.
Or Magdalena, the prostitute from Costa Rica who never showed her face. Or Tobias, the young farmer from Panama. He was the first to pass away.
As weeks passed by, Little Maria and Juana got closer and closer to the river that divided Mexico and the U.S. But one night, Little Juana was sleeping in a dark wagon in the Bestia when...
Wake up!
Oh, what is it?
I heard gunshots.
Where's La Boya?
I don't know. She was here when I fell asleep.
Of course she should be here. Why did she leave?
Carlos, you have to run.
La Boya, what happened?
Run!
From 1,000 miles away.
Please promise me you'll get there. They all be watching you next to Godwin.
Ah, there you are, you sleepy putita. My name is love, little cunts like you. Sick to love, the virgin's blood.
Just try and touch me, Sarah, the murder!
Resumed its course. Little Juana could hear her sister's screams as she was torn apart by the Zetas. Little Juana was in so much pain she thought she was going to die. But just when she was about to give in, she remembered the promise she had made with her family to meet in the magical land where all the dreams come true. Still, he was the only one she had left.
Escúchenme, Diosito. I implore with all my faith. Take care of mama and sister who are there with you today.
in you, my God, I understand my pain. It's just a test, and with your grace, I will see better days. Lord, be dead, are those pobres, and all of those who are dead. The migrants who had families and had to give their lives. And also those who died alone and do not have a name. I'll be the one who prays for them because they've no one else.
And before she knew it, this Alana had traveled all the way from Honduras to the Rio Bravo, where she realized she didn't know how to swim.
But I've come so far, nothing's gonna stop me now. I'm gonna throw myself to the river. I'm gonna move my body like those fishes. I'm gonna walk the water like Jesus. I'm gonna fly high as a bird, even higher.
And before she knew it, Little Wanda had arrived in America after crossing the Rio Bravo and reached the land of dreams.
Thousands of tons of bananas.
I bought more companies to create United Fruit.
Studiac plantations in all of Central America and the Caribbean. All those countries became banana republics for the U.S. Paradises where fruits and soil grew from the soil at absolutely no expense.
Then, President William McKinley visited Mexico to meet the new dictator.
Build all the railways you want with cheap Mexican hands, but you pay first. Your companies are welcome, but they pay first. No se olvide, President McKinley, if there are riots against me, you intervene.
During General Porfirio's regime, millions of families lived perpetually indebted to the companies that paid them less than enough to survive.
Meanwhile, Cuba, Puerto Rico, and the Philippines were all fighting for their independence.
We declare war on Spain to free its colonies in the name of the Monroe Doctrine!
The prize for this easy war was huge.
Puerto Rico and Cuba became banana republics for United Fruit.
And then the Philippines were occupied under a policy McKinley called benevolent assimilation.
But we want our independence so much, Filipinos. We're not in the U.S.
Over 20,000 soldiers and 200,000 civilians died in the Philippine-American War.
Ah, things are going so well!
Then McKinley was killed by a young working-class anarchist.
When he was sentenced to death, this was the only thing that Leon Czolgosz said.
I killed him because he was an enemy of the good working people.
In his last will, McKinley left something really special for the U.S. A commercial empire of banana republics throughout the Caribbean and the Pacific Ocean.
And his successor was Teddy Roosevelt.
He accepted Panama's independence and threatened the Colombian government to accept it as well.
And in exchange, he was granted rights to build the Panama Canal.
In 1902, Britain, Germany, and Italy attacked Venezuela to settle some debts.
But Venezuela was coming out of a war that killed a quarter of its population.
The international community thought Teddy Roosevelt would protect Venezuela.
Europe is taking more colonies than ever. If they find any reason to attack any of these poor fucking South Americans, then they will threaten our national interests.
Instead, he added the Roosevelt corollary to the Monroe Doctrine.
We have the right to attack any nation in the Americas to prevent Europe from attacking them, because in doing so, we are protecting ourselves.
Teddy was clever. He used Geronimo, then an elderly prisoner, as propaganda.
Look! Even this fucktard Indian warlord supports the American way. He's a Christian now. He's even working like a decent American.
He was forced to appear in parades as an attraction, to grant him one last wish.
There is no climate or soil which is equal to that of Arizona. It is my land, my home, my father's land, which I now ask to be allowed to return. I want to spend my last days there and be buried among those mountains. If this could be, I might die in peace, feeling that my people are back in their homes and that our name would not become extinct. If I must die in bondage, it is my hope that, when I am gone, we are granted our one last wish to return to Arizona.
Neither of Geronimo's requests were granted.
He died in captivity after he fell off his horse. He was almost 90 years old.
He's buried in Oklahoma, 1,000 miles away from his home.
Marine Corps Major General Smedley Butler, the most decorated Marine in history at the time of his own death, would later describe his role in Central America.
I served in all the ranks up to Major General. I was a muscle man for Wall Street and the bankers. I was a racketeer for capitalism. My mental faculties remained in suspended animation while I obeyed orders. This is typical of everyone in service. I made Tampico safe for our oil interests. I made Cuba and Haiti right for the central bank. I helped in the raping of 6 Central American republics. I brought to light the Dominican Republic
of dress, right for our fruit companies. I was rewarded with honors, medals, and promotions. I might have even given Al Capone a few hits. He operated his racket on three city districts, we Marines on three continents.
Teddy's success as President William Howard Taft and Woodrow Wilson enhanced his policies in Latin America.
They started a new dollar diplomacy.
In exchange, they took the dollar as official trade and currency.
When the Central American currencies dropped in front of the dollar,
families saw their debts doubled or tripled, millions went bankrupt, children mortality rose to an alarming 35%.
Banana republics were crippled.
Thanks to my dollar diplomacy, our bankers are now the wealthiest men in history.
In the first years of his presidency,
I attacked Haiti, the Dominican Republic, and Nicaragua, who refused to pay.
And he attacked Mexico a couple of times.
We've overthrown the government of the treacherous General Huerta.
Then he tried to kill Pancho Villa, a warlord he had provided with weapons at first.
I chose Venustiano Carranza as Mexican president, but the savage was furious.
On March the 9th, 1916, Pancho Villa attacked the 13th Cavalry Regime in Columbus, becoming one of the very few people to successfully invade U.S. soil.
Wilson sent 5,000 troops into Mexico to hunt down Villa, yet he escaped.
But I got half their oil deposits, 65% of their mines, and more for the U.S.
Then in 1954, he started the war on drugs, the longest lasting war in history that continues even today.
Meanwhile, in the Caribbean, he started a series of conflicts called the Banana Wars.
Then Wilson campaigned.
I kept peace as promised. I kept us out of the Great War.
Millions of Americans were employed in the army due to his appeasement speeches.
They were dragged into World War I. Thousands never returned.
One thing more.
Wilson ensured that both the winning and losing parties in the war would use American loans to rebuild. Transferred their external debt to their colonies, port for port.
U.S. banks were filled with millions of dollars from the Caribbean, where the working class paid for a war wage thousands of miles away from home.
The Banana Republic saw their most tragic episodes after the war.
In 1928, the Clark Memorandum was released, stating that
U.S. don't need to invoke Monroe. We have the right to self-defend, to attack any nation in the Americas where our interests are threatened.
Politicians were bribed to overlook people's humiliating conditions.
United Fruit kept 5,000 of its workers, but only 200 of them had contracts.
As tensions escalated, a general strike broke down on the 12th of November, 1928.
United Fruit demanded protection. Fearing that the U.S. would intervene, thousands of soldiers from the Colombian army arrived in plantations.
General Carlos Cortez Vargas decided he would end the repression by force. So on December 5th, thousands of workers were gathered with their families in a railway station.
But first, he made sure that all the U.S. businessmen were safely on their way home. And as described by Nobel laureate Gabriel Garcia Marquez in his novel 100 Years of Solitude, an army colonel made a warning before the massacre.
Under current martial law, it is illegal to hold groups of more than three men! Refusal to withdraw will mean that
your extra medic! Were murdered in cold blood.
It's impossible to know how many people died in the Banana Wars.
U.S. companies had thousands of employees, dead bodies were instantly disposed of, thousands of lives just faded away.
Governments and companies would always hide this information.
Estimates range from 20,000 to 500,000 people killed during the Banana Wars. Roosevelt became president. 25% of the U.S. population was unemployed.
But the world is still dependent on the U.S. that the crisis quickly spread.
Europe saw the rise of Hitler and Mussolini. Millions of people died from famine in China and the USSR.
In Central America, after so much war, banana republics smelled like rotting fruit and corpses.
And Roosevelt had the future in his hands.
In his first address to the Congress, he described the condition of his people.
Taxes have risen, our ability to pay has fallen, millions of Americans are unemployed, thousands of families have lost their homes.
His New Deal policies created 30 million new jobs for unemployed Americans.
And through this employment, we will accomplish greatly needed projects.
He provided economic relief and housing, and stated that
no business which pays less than living wages to its workers has any right to be in this country.
He reformed the banking system and then raised taxes on the richest companies.
Against the return of the evils of the old order, the bankers who were bailed through their stubbornness and incompetence.
He provided social security and labor rights for and then social programs for the millions who were unemployed or homeless.
And I found in Major General Smedley Butler a brave man willing to denounce the hypocrisy and corruption of the industry of war.
Over 21,000 millionaires and billionaires were made in the U.S. during the war. How many of them shouldered a rifle? How many of them dug a trench? How many of them were hungry in rat-infested dugouts? How many of them spent sleepless, frightened nights ducking shells and shrapnel and machine gun bullets? How many of them died in battle?
We'll follow General Butler's advice to revolutionize the war industry.
We must take the profit out of war. It must be left to the youth who would bear arms to decide if there should be war and must only wage war for home defense purposes.
In Latin America, Roosevelt's good neighbor policy ended occupations and established equitable conditions of trade.
In 1938, Mexico nationalized its oil and expropriated all deposits when foreign labor companies refused to pay labor rights.
America lost its second main source of oil. No war was fought, but the economy grew.
But this era of diplomacy ended with the outburst of the greatest war in history.
Roosevelt's diplomacy died with him before the end of the war.
And then, President Truman had a different approach.
Thank you.
drug cartels are more dangerous than ever.
This is the war on drugs started every year. The death toll is higher, just like the budget for war.
Won't get a second chance.